Please be seated. Today I have for the young people's message, what do we need? No, that's fine. We can do it from there. One day I went to visit somebody in a jail. And I got in there to visit her, but every door was unlocked for me. There was a gentleman standing there unlocking me into this one, and this one, and this one. And so I did my visiting and had a great time, and it came out, and of course the jailer came again. He unlocked the door so I could get out of that room, put me in another room, unlocked that door, and opened another door to me and said, here, you can go out this door. He didn't open that door. He didn't do anything. He just shut the other door behind me. So I'm standing in this little bitty room, and I'm waiting for somebody to come in and help me get out of here, because the door is locked on both sides. There's no going back and there's no going forward. Now, what am I going to do? I don't know how to get out of here. I don't know the code. I don't even know what to do. So there's this little tiny box over on the side that had holes in it. Okay. Maybe it's a speaker system, because there was like a button on the bottom of it. I said, well, maybe it's just a speaker system that I can at least have somebody push the button and they'll let me out. Well, actually, when you push the button, it clicked. So, but you wanted to hold your finger on it while it clicked so you could open the door at the same time, because once you let your finger off, it was back locked again. So, today we're going to read about the apostles. They are again thrown in prison. And how do they get out? So what do we need to get out? We need a key, or we need a combination for anything to get out. Today we're going to see what the apostles had in order for them to get out of jail again. So our scripture is still taken from Acts. And we find that after Sapphira and their lying to the Holy Spirit and all that went on. So we start actually with verse 12. Because the shock of that, the people really listened to the disciples. They loved what they said before, but there was fear that came over them. Because both Sapphira and Ananias had died for lying to the Holy Spirit and for lying to God. And let me tell you, that makes you watch your voice. It makes you watch what you're going to say. It makes one tell the truth. And that's what they were not doing. They were not telling the truth to God. And so we go from that point. And it's so. And though through the hands of the apostles, many signs and wonders were done among the people. And they were all in one accord in Solomon's porch. Yet none of the rest dared join them. But the people esteemed them highly, and the believers were increasingly added to the Lord, multitudes of both men and women, that they brought the sick out to the streets and laid them on the beds and couches, that at least the shadow of Peter passing by might fall on some of them. Also a multitude gathered from the surrounding cities to Jerusalem, bringing sick people and those who were tormented by unclean spirits, and they were healed. Then the high priest arose and all those who were with him and the Sadducees, and they were filled with indignation, and they laid their hands on the apostles and put them in a common prison. But at night, an angel of the Lord opened the prison doors and brought them out and said, go stand in the temple and speak to the people all the words of life. And when they had heard that, they entered the temple early in the morning and taught. But the high priest and all those came, and he called the council together with all the elders and the children of Israel, and sent to the prison and had them brought. But when the officers came and did not find them in the prison, they returned and reported, saying, indeed, we have found the prison shut securely, and a guard standing outside before the doors. But when we opened them, we found no one inside. Now the high priest and the captain of the temple and the chief priests heard these things. They wondered what the outcome would be. So they came and told them, saying, look, the men whom you put in prison are standing in the temple and teaching the people. Then the captain went with the officers and brought them without violence, for they feared the people, lest they should be stoned. And when they had brought them, they set them before the council. And the high priest said to them, did we not strictly command you not to teach in this name? And look, you have filled Jerusalem with your doctrine and intend to bring this man's blood on us. But Peter and the other apostles answered and said, we ought to obey God rather than men. Then God the Father raised up Jesus, whom you murdered by hanging on a tree. Him God has exalted to his right hand to be Prince and Savior, to give repentance to Israel and forgiveness of sins. And we are witnesses to these things. And so also it is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who obey him. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, these are words that you have written down on a page for us into the scriptures to teach us, that we might learn how you work, that we might learn to be bold and brave as we stand and as we proclaim your word and not worry about what the world thinks. We thank you, Lord. Please continue to imprint that deep upon our hearts and our minds and our souls, to worship you and to follow you and you alone. We ask all these things in the blessed, 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 blessed name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior, and the Son of the living God. Hallelujah and amen. Today we come and we see again the disciples had already been arrested once. Where did they go? Back out to Solomon's porch. Solomon's porch is part of the temple. It's a big, long area on this side. And they were going to do what God told them. It didn't make a difference what the Romans wanted. It didn't make a difference what the Sadducees or the Pharisees wanted. They had a higher calling. And that calling was through Jesus Christ. And as they walked with him and talked with him, in fact, so many people came to them that it just got to be an abundant crowd. If you listen to the high priest and his comment, and it wasn't a compliment, it was a comment. You have filled this place with your people. He was not happy about all the people that were coming in, because they were coming in from all over, outside of Jerusalem, any place. Their doctors at that point in time were the apostles. They brought people in. They even had the saying that if you just lay them down, just bring them on the bed, lay them on the bed and leave them there. And maybe, just maybe, the shadow of Peter walking by would save them. Now that's in the scripture, but that's not in the law, okay? It was the tradition in other religions that people have the power and authority that if they walk by people, other people will be healed. Now, I do not doubt at all that some were healed. I do not doubt that a bit. Because if you believe hard enough in your mind sometimes, because a lot of our emotional problems and disease problems are more mind thought than they are anything. If we think we're sick, we're going to be sick. If we think we have a limp, we develop a limp. It's just the mind kind of works towards us. What we think sometimes happens. So if I'm laying a sick one there, in my mind, I believe from what I have heard in all the healings that they have done, and Jesus Christ being raised from the dead, and Lazarus being raised from the dead, why would I not believe in my heart that maybe just by passing by, I would be healed? And a lot of them were. A lot of them would take up their bed and walk. It doesn't say that here, but you know what happened because more people came all the time. They were always there. And this made the Pharisees and the Sadducees very upset because they were not listening to the Pharisees and the Sadducees at all. They were going and they were finding out where help truly was coming from. not just the healing, but the words of life. The healing is added on. The words of the life in the gospel are the most important thing that was here this day. They were telling them about Jesus Christ. They did not tell how I healed. They were telling them that it is Jesus Christ of Nazareth who is the healer here in this place. And what happens to them again? Again. It didn't work the first time. This is the second time. Again, they're back in jail, in a prison. I do not know how many apostles there are, who's all included in this. If it's just John and Peter, or if it's all of the apostles. I would think all of them would be there because of the sheer number of people that were there. When you fill a city, you need more than two. And so the apostles were all thrown in jail. A common prison, it's called. Locked in for the night. You don't hear nothing. Everything is silent there. Except a messenger from the Lord came. I was reading in one of the descriptions that a messenger of the Lord could have been a man. This was not a man. This was not a man. Because he went in and he brought out the apostles out of the prison. Which seems normal. But not when you have guards and men standing outside the door and the doors are locked. And they have the key. But this messenger came out with them. I do not know how that happened. I don't know if they went out the door. I don't know where they went. But they were outside. And the message for them was to what? The message was to go back to the temple. Wait a minute, we've already been there. We've been arrested twice by being there. But their question, they did not question that. The morning they got up, and the first thing they did is went to the temple. It makes you kind of think, would we do that? Knowing that we'd probably be arrested again, only it could be worse. Their whole ideas and their whole thoughts was obedience unto the Lord God. Obedience unto Jesus Christ. It did not make a difference what was going to happen to them. They knew their heart was set on one thing and one thing alone, and that was being followers of Jesus Christ. That's a pretty big F, isn't it? But they went, and they stood there, and they preached. The amazing thing was the scribes and the Pharisees didn't even know that they were gone. Didn't know that the prison doors had been opened and they were let out. So they went to all the guards. It's tough to be a guard of a prison and your prisoners have left. It's not highly recommended that you want to do that. But this is not the first time with them that they have been released from a spot. And so they go and they just figure they're going to bring all of them in before the wise council that would talk to them and tell them or whatever, beat them or whatever. And so they get there and talk to the guards, and the guards open the door. The guards are still standing there. Opens the door and goes in to let them out. And no one's there. He has a tough job. He has to go back and tell the Sadducees and the Pharisees and all of those that are gathered in this room that there is no one there. There is nobody to bring me. They're gone. Can you imagine the murmur in that room? Who let them out? No, no. Guards are still standing there. Doors were still locked. Somebody had to let them out. Who let them out? Can you imagine the conversation back and forth there? Somebody's going to pay for this. Huh, human nature. They're not going to get away from this. But a gentleman comes. It doesn't say who. It says, I've seen them. I've seen them. Where are they? They're back again in the temple, preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ, which has all of the power and authority. Hallelujah. We're not brave enough yet to look and see, can I go back and preach just like that? Can we do that? This morning again in prayer time, before I came, I was thinking about praying for other people. And we're so afraid to do that. And I agree with you. I agree with you. It's kind of scary to walk up and pray for other people. Or if other people engage you, to say, can I pray for you? Why is that so intimidating for us? It is for me, I got to tell you that. But why? What are we so afraid of? Are we afraid we don't know how to pray? Are we afraid we'll insult them? You're actually commenting them, complimenting them. Can I pray for you? The other night again, I was at a ball game, and I walk away and I have to stop doing that. A lady seen our sign on a car, and she said, where's Howick? She didn't know where Howick was, and so I told her where Howick was. You know, we're expecting them to say, will you pray for me as long as there's a prayer warrior on your door? We're waiting for you to do that. As long as we have a prayer warrior on my door, I should be the one, would you like prayer? If she tells me no, so what? But if she tells me yes, then God sent her there. And I could take no pretty easily. But the disciples here, what did they do? They didn't say, no, we can't go back. This is too dangerous for us. You know they're going to come back and get us again. Third time is not a good time. No. They rose in the morning and they went, knowing in their heart. First of all, they are obedient unto the messenger. They are obedient. And the messenger said, tell them the words of life. And what is, I had to look it up, what are the words of life? The words of life is Jesus Christ died for you. Jesus Christ has forgiven you your sins. Jesus Christ is asking you to follow after him and you will have eternal life. Not just life in this world, but eternal life. The words of life. Think about that. You will have life and your sins will be forgiven. That is huge for all of us. And so they went and back. But who shows up? The Sadducees, the Pharisees, all of them that are gathering around. But they're intimidated by the disciples. They are actually themselves afraid of the disciples. Because it says here, they took them without violence. Why? Because they were afraid they were going to be stoned by the people. It's really difficult to tell somebody that they're wrong when their loved ones are up and walking, when the dead have been raised, when leprosy has been cleansed, when people that have been crippled are now walking and leaping and praise the Lord. Yes, it's very difficult to fight against that. So again, what do? They gather them in and they bring them back to the council that they are going to bring before. And the dumbest words come out of their mouth. Did we not tell you this before not to speak about this man? They wouldn't even call him Jesus. Just this man. Wouldn't dignify his name. Let alone the Son of God. Never would that cross their lips. They had no idea what they're going to do with these. They're a thorn in their side. They're doing what God has sent them to do. And the people that God chose from the beginning of time should have been doing it all along. These are not strangers. These are the Israelites. These are the people of God rejecting the Son of God. Rejecting those that came to minister to the Son of God and now are disciples. Because they like their world the way it is. And he's going to change my world. You want to see what it looks like? Let me see. Try Donald Trump. Think that's kind of a stir there? Think that's kind of when he talks about draining the swamp? He hasn't made any friends. These disciples did not make friends either with the leadership. None whatsoever. I'm not saying, by the way, Donald Trump is right or wrong. It's just an example. But the leadership of the family of God does not want anything to do with Jesus Christ. They don't want anything to do with the disciples. But the problem here is, what do we do with them? If we take them out and we beat them, or if we destroy them and we slay them, we will have such an uproar in our land that we'll never get over it. And if you read on a little bit more in the next section, there's a wise man there. And he comes up to them and he says, if you do that, we're in trouble. If you take them out and stone them, we are all in trouble. What can we do? And his answer was, there has been sex in our nation that has risen and fallen over the years. They come in a hot flash, and they're really a threat for a while. And after a while, it all wanes away, and they are no more. And he said, this might be the same thing here, that the disciples will just wane away. But he said his wisest words, if this is of man, it will never last. If this is of man. But if this is of God, you will never stop it. Wise. He hasn't stopped. It is still here, alive today. Alive and well. It is amazing that I am picking up more and more on the TV, more and more on radio, more and more in sports, that people are standing up and proclaiming the message of Jesus Christ. They are stopped being afraid. I know the other voices holler louder, but the voice of Christ is coming through loud and clear here. Friday, the voice of God spoke again to Derek. He had a courtier, and I know you probably are tired of Derek, but I gotta use him because God has placed him in our presence as a person that we have actually brought Jesus Christ. We have made a way for him. And he was really worried that he didn't exactly know it's for child care, for child support. And he wants to go to Teen Challenge, but Project Turnabout also has its hand in there. He hasn't been able to talk to Candy Light County, other than in jail. And so actually when he went there, he had no idea what without term was going to be, where it was going to go. He sat down and he talked to his lawyer. See how God changes people? He sat down and talked to his lawyer, a lawyer that he did not like, a lawyer that really didn't like him either. She had reason why not to like him. Because at that point in time in his language wasn't good, his thoughts weren't good or anything. He apologized to her. Imagine that. He apologized to her and said he was sorry for what he had said to her and wished he hadn't said. And he meant it fully with his heart. And the lawyer says to us, something has changed in you. When you are on drugs, you are horrible. You are arrogant. You have a mouth that won't stop. But I see in you now somebody entirely different than what I really knew you had. The Lord touched him that day. The Lord also touched the judge that day. He is a sign for January County, the Teen Challenge. He'll be there for 13 months. They have also lifted his child support for that month because he can't raise money in person. This is what
all of those people that were in Jerusalem that were bringing their sick ones in, that were hearing the message of Jesus Christ. It's not about Gary, but it's about Jesus Christ and how he changes us. How he builds us into something entirely different. How he puts joy in us that we never thought we could ever have joy. I don't think you can be a crab and be a Christian. I think you can try, but I don't think the two go together at all. We follow the Lord Jesus Christ. We follow him well. But I have to say, we can do better. We can do better. Spend your day with him. It doesn't have to be all day. Take time in the morning. Just walk in. If it's your bedroom or if it's a closet or wherever it is, just say, Lord, I love you today. Period. You know how excited God would be to hear that? So, the disciples were not going to quit. They were not going to quit just because man said, don't do this anymore. No. We have a choice. And the choice is the same as theirs. Do we follow God or do we follow man? Do we follow the truth or do we follow hot air? That dissipates and goes nowhere. We already know the answer. We follow the truth. Let us pray. Heavenly